If you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain. It's free. There's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard in Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place. All right, everybody, and welcome to the Pro Zone. This is Rick, and as always, joining me this week is JJ and Danny. How the fuck are you guys?
What's going on?
And this week, we are doing one of our retro reviews where we are just 3 days shy of the anniversary of Great American Bash 1990. So, Baltimore, Maryland, July 7th, 1990. This is the final Great American Bash held under the NWA banner. And it had a attendance of 14,000. And was the tagline was the new revolution. And overall, before we get into breaking the entire show down, this was one of the periods during the National Wrestling Alliance. I was pretty heavy into it for about another year. Going back, I don't understand why the fuck I was so into it, I really did. I ended up enjoying it over the year. I did enjoy it overall. But some matches, I'm kind of, confused about. What did you guys think overall so far before we, break it down?
This was a tough one to watch for me. I mean, at the beginning I could tolerate it, but by the time we got to like the main events, like the championship matches, you know, it was kind of like, I just couldn't really grasp into it. I mean, until the main event, of course.
Yeah. JJ, what did you think?
I loved it. I loved everything about it, man. Everything from the match, even like earlier we spoke about the matches look good on paper, but they weren't good in the ring.
That's right. Prior to recording, yeah, there was some matches.
Yes, I loved it. Overall, I loved it. A lot of good storytelling. I loved it. I loved it overall.
You could definitely tell the direction that WCW or NWA, whichever, was going into trying to be a more, gearing towards family-oriented stuff, with the exception of some of the crowd chants, but we'll get into that by the time I think Dan and I discussed this earlier.
Yeah.
I can't believe those chants.
I had to ask Dan to confirm that that was what they were actually saying.
The first comment, I can't really confirm, but that's what it sounded like they were saying. And then, obviously, the second chant that went on after that was kind of obvious. I was like, all right. Right.
Before we end up getting into the match, there was a dark match. I looked up David Sierra, who I believe wrestled as the Cuban Assassin, defeated Mr. X. I don't no idea which version of Mr. X this was, because it was a pretty common name back in the day. Obviously, it's a dark match, so we have no idea what the fuck happened. Going by the Mr. X, the link on Wikipedia, it does not bring up an actual Mr. X. Like, it brings up the original guy from whatever, the 60s that wrestled. So,
I wouldn't be surprised, especially under the NWA banner at that time. You know, guys were still pretty much going on at that time for, 30, 40 years. You know, you look at guys that like, you even look at the card, of course. You look at like Harley Race and Tommy Rich. Iron Sheik, those guys were already going at it for like a good 20 years at that point, so I wouldn't be surprised.
One of the things I was very surprised about with Harley Race, now I don't ever remember him making a wrestling comeback in the NWA. at that time period. I remember seeing him both in WWF wrestle Haku probably like a few months earlier at the Royal Rumble. Was it 89 or 1990? It might have been 89. But in that year and a half span, it might have been the 89. But in that time span of like a year and a half, he wrestled, Harley Race wrestled there, the WWF, the NWA, and he wrestled Larry Zbysko for the world title in the AWA as well. So he was kind of probably not under any contract to anybody. He was just kind of like bouncing around, it seems like.
Yeah, back then it was handshake deals, wasn't it?
Yeah, pretty much, yep.
That's cool. Yeah, that's cool. But it's not like that no more, but whatever. First match, I love. We're going to get to it. First match was amazing. You had Brian Pillman versus, what was it, Nature Boy Buddy Landell.
Let me tell you something about this match, though. This match was very much a styles clash. You know, you had two wrestlers with two different styles, and, you know, it was kind of off balance. And another thing that kind of made this match odd was another Nature Boy. Like, why have another Nature Boy when you already have, you know, you have a Nature Boy in the beginning of the card, and you have a Nature Boy at the end of the card, which I kind of find ironic in a way.
That's what I thought.
Well, one of the things was with Buddy Landell when he returned to the NWA at the time period, he was kind of pretty much just a preliminary wrestler, not necessarily going after many titles or anything like that. He was basically doing a lot of jobs for people. But if you looked in the National Wrestling Alliance 3 years earlier, maybe four, they were he was going to be set up for a feud with Ric Flair over the Nature Boy name. But they ended up canceling that before it even happened. So to have him come in the NWA while the Nature Boy Ric Flair is already there, they just having the both of them use the name was it was kind of confusing to me then. Especially it had to be to young fans that were watching. So I don't understand why they didn't just take the Nature Boy name with them away from him, because he was pretty Ric Flair is pretty synonymous with the NWA, the WCW version of NWA. So.
And let me tell you something. You know, if you were like 10, 12 years old at that time, how can you not love Brian Pillman, especially for his Arsenal style? You know, the way, you know, he would just perform in the ring, he was so ahead of his time. He was doing moves that wouldn't be done till like the late 90s. I mean, even not just Brian Pillman himself, but if you look at guys like Dynamite Kid, Jushin Liger, and Owen Hart, you know, he was one of those guys you can categorize and be, all right, he's definitely elevating the game in the early 90s that we haven't even reached the peak yet. So,
Yeah, you're right. And I love how Pillman always opens. It seems to me every WCW show, Pillman is always opening the show.
He was the guy they put in charge of getting the crowd fired up.
Yeah. You know,
this is definitely I remember this theme song that he used.
Loved it. I remember it
because just a few months earlier, he was using like Def Leppard's Rocket as his ring entrance music, which I thought was kind of funny. He was using like an edited version of that. So, but this one wasn't that bad. Yeah, this one wasn't bad. Brian Pillman with the win at 9:29.
Yeah, and that was great. I was happy he won. And like you said, he was putting over Buddy Landell was putting over new talent.
Yeah.
Like, That was what he was doing. So that's awesome. After that, we had a promo, a Harley Race promo. No, I'm sorry. After that, there was a Sheik versus Rotunda.
This is like, if you go back 5 years at the very first WrestleMania, they wrestled each other in a tag match. Sorry, Dan, to cut you off. They wrestled each other in a tag match with, you know, Volkoff and Nikolai against Barry and Rotunda. And that was one of the best matches of the fucking show. These guys, the Sheik looked like he was fucking struggling to get through this match. And it was only 6 minutes long.
Let me tell you what was so funny about this. Ross was talking about in his commentary about, you know, Mike Rotunda's amateur wrestling background. But by the time we actually got to this year, he was going under a Navy captain, hence the name Captain Mike Rotunda.
Right, because he went from the varsity club Captain Mike Rotunda. They started building him up as a babyface. If I remember correctly, because I was watching pretty heavily at the time, there was no babyface turn. I think he just one day showed up in a babyface outfit. He had the fucking captain's the anchor on the back of his trunks, wearing that fucking like jacket you buy at like a yacht jacket that you buy in like a naval store or some bullshit. And he's wearing the stupid fucking hat. To put Mike Rotunda, a guy that was like one of the greatest wrestlers, like serious wrestlers of all time, through a childish gimmick like that, it was just fucking bullshit.
I didn't get it. When I saw him, I immediately thought, Boston Ho, Boston Ho. That's what I immediately thought. Better give me my Boston Ho. That's what I thought. I'm like, what's going on here? But because I watched nothing but old WCW, I was like, oh, okay, this is that Mike Rotunda. I wasn't familiar with it back then, but I got familiar with it about, you know, 4 or 5 years ago in the network stuff. Right. Yeah. So
I mean, overall, this wasn't bad. It was just like a generic match. You know, you had Iron Sheik showing some generic heel off, and he was really just struggling. You know, I even seen him struggling trying to put on an abdominal stretch. I was like, dude, are you good? You know, he's like sweating throughout the whole
thing. Yeah, he walked into the fucking arena sweaty. He looked like he was having trouble keeping his composure, like as a, not necessarily as a character, but just walking.
As a person?
That's what
drugs do to you. So, I'm not trying to shit on anybody, but everybody knows about his drug issues. Let's just face it.
It's well documented. There's a documentary out there. I don't know if you two have seen it or not. It's on Amazon Prime, and I highly recommend watching it. It's very good. It's very good.
I'll have to watch that.
After this
match, we had the Harley Race promo. Decent promo. I don't know. I've seen Harley Race cut better promos back then, but it was decent. I don't know how you feel about that. Let's see. After the promo, you had Dutch versus Doug Furness. Yeah, Dutch, the Dirty Dutch Mantel versus Doug Furness.
This one. Okay, so something Dan said struck me about this match. It's like with Pillman and Landell being a mismatch, and then me saying that Rotunda and Sheik had like a. You know, like I said, 5 years earlier, they had like a really great match at WrestleMania 1 in a tag match. But this match seemed like a very big mismatch. Dutch Mantel is one of those guys that can work with anybody. You know what I mean? He's just a great wrestler and great heel. Doug Furness, he was still relatively young, probably like a year or so into the business, maybe even a few months. But I'm going to tell you something. Watching this match, watching him deliver a drop kick, I decided that he's got one of the best fucking drop kicks I've ever seen. He did it. He landed perfectly clean on the chest of Dutch Mantel, and the delivery was just, it was beautiful, and it was amazing.
And something that I found ironic, too, was he was actually known as the world's strongest man as a nickname at that time.
That's
he was
cool.
a weightlifter. Yeah, yep. He was a body lifter. Yeah, he was competing in, weightlifting competitions and such. So
I want to know, Rick, can you answer this? What happened to Doug Furness? Is there a these are my notes. Is there a controversy with Doug Furness? To me, this guy could have been a white meat face. That guy, you know what I'm saying? He could have been
baby face. Yep.
Watching this, he could have been big. And I don't know too much about him.
No, he went on to wrestle in Japan for a number of years as a tag team with Phil LaFon. Yep. And
that's why I know about him.
They wrestled in WWF. They made some appearances for ECW. Unfortunately, in 2012, Doug Furness passed. He had some sort of heart issue, and he was only 52 years old. But he's going to go down as possibly one of the most underrated professional wrestlers in the history of the business, because I don't think that he ever had the opportunity to have a really awesome like singles run. He looked like he was built to have a great singles run in like WWF or WCW or, you know, on top. And unfortunately, it doesn't seem like he got really in the tag team division, got a really good run with Phil LaFon in All Japan. And they were one of the greatest tag teams over there. They've had some incredible matches. Go look them up on YouTube. They came into WWF and worked a little bit, and they made a few appearances in ECW as well, but not much in the United, by way of United States. I think he might've wrestled in Stampede. I could be completely off by that, but Okay. He might have.
I believe we spoke on him last week, I believe. Somehow we spoke on him, and I vaguely knew about them because of their brief stint in WWF. But, yeah, I was impressed by that guy. I was. I loved
He's got that nice in there. He's got some nice suplexes in there. He's had that nice snap belly-to-belly on Dutch Mantel. And Dutch Mantel was brought in around this time for the same reason that I feel that Buddy Landell was. He was just putting a lot of the younger talent over and making them look nice. And so pretty much the same thing, you know. Unfortunately,
and I loved, was
a legend at the time.
He was. Okay, I didn't know that. And I love Jim Ross's commentary on Brutus, how he was putting over his college football career. I really enjoyed that.
I'll tell you why that is. They're both from Oklahoma. Anybody from Oklahoma, you know, JR puts over, like, how high he was in Dr. Death Steve Williams. So that's the series you should watch in All Japan is Furnace and LaFon against Dr. Death and Terry Gordy. So those are some fucking brutal-ass matches. Yep.
We'll have to do that stuff.
Absolutely. YouTube, it's a wonderful tool.
I know, it is great. we know
so,
that.
This next match really got me. Harley Race took on Tommy Rich. Now, if you know, this is 1990. 9 years earlier in 1981, Tommy Rich defeated Harley Race for the world title.
Yes.
They gave him 6 minutes and 32 seconds in this match, and it was one of the...
It was interesting.
I mean, Harley, the thing is, Harley Race looked better than Tommy Rich in this match, and he's like, what, probably 50-something, almost 60 years old in this match?
Let me tell you something. Tommy Rich, he didn't almost sell the pile driver.
Yes. Yeah, you're right. Yep.
Yeah, I saw that.
And basically, they were just fighting in and outside the ring the whole time. And then when Tommy Rich finally goes for a diving crossbody, Harley Race just plays, you know, an old school tactic. Oh, I'm just going to go for the roll up.
Yeah. I was trying to wonder because I was sitting there, you know, there's been times I've seen Tommy Rich watching old WCW around the time period. And I'm like, does this guy ever really have it? I know that he was kind of a transitional champion. That's why he, from what I understand, he defeated Harley Race because there was some sort of bidding war on who the next champion was and whatever promoter won. And they took it on him. But was he ever really that popular or really that great? I mean, I know he had a really good run in Memphis. You know, I don't see like in Georgia that I never thought he was really that great. I mean, I thought he was pretty good, but I don't know if he was NWA world champion. I mean, anybody that put the NWA world title on is basically the king of kings, kind of, you know what I mean? As far as like world champions, they don't
I mean, they basically did hype up this match because the way they built the match, they basically declared it as a battle between two great former world champions.
Yeah, it was hyped up. My concern was with Harley Race. Did he really hit his head on the apron when they both went over? Did he really hit his head on that?
I think he really did hit it on on the side of the side.
Yeah,
of the
when they both went
down.
Over, that looked nasty. Even the commentating and again throughout the whole. Card. I loved the commentating between Ross and who else was it? Ross and
Bob Caudle, the legendary Bob Caudle, who after he left the NWA, he would go on to South Atlantic Pro Wrestling, which is a really underrated territory. It didn't last long, and he spent a lot of time in Smoky Mountain Wrestling for pretty much its duration. So,
And then the name Bob Caudle does sound familiar. Listening,
he's a really good commentator. Yep.
Podcast and everything. I love the suplex on the runway during that match. Yeah, I love the use of the runway. I don't know how other fans feel about it, but I love the runway.
The thing with that is, like, WCW used it a lot in the earlier 90s, probably like 1990, 91-ish. They used it for a lot of the Clash Champions and pay-per-view events for much of the earlier 90s. I'm like, why'd they do away with it? It looks so cool, and it looked... serious, you know, the only other place I really see that in is like New Japan or something. I don't ever see it anywhere else. So to see that, you know, in the WCW event, I mean, WWE never used it to my knowledge. The only time I ever saw them use it was when they're in the Maple Leaf Gardens back in the 80s. So, I know I'm going a little too deep here. I'm sorry,
but at least you know that it's existed. And yeah. I don't know how other fans feel about it, but I like that look. Like, I don't know. Yeah, and
looks,
you dig it.
It looks good. I mean, it looks good. There's the whole, it's the whole ramp. And then in the background, you know, it's got, you know, it's got like the big gigantic WCW logo in the background. Mm-hmm. So it just, it, it, it's,
add
decoration. Right. And it's, this
it
is
the feng shui.
Yeah. It looks, WCW, I think this, it was pretty underrated though. I mean, at this time period, WCW, this is like before they were coming off a really hot run of a really great year of 1989 being like their fucking best year. And, you know, the roster that they had, it just seemed like, you know, they were starting to go more towards a cartoonish type thing. Jim Herd had come in as president, yada, 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 and all the fucking bullshit with him. But, you know, it just seemed, a little strange, you know, but they had, I think there's a lot of underrated stuff. And I think you and I have talked about that, JJ, that things of are in this era of NWA starting in 90, 91 or WCW, that it was, there's some underrated items, but there's also, you know, a lot of shit to fucking weed out. You got to weed out all the fucking, go through all the shit. So
weed out all the bullshit.
Yeah,
the next match, the next match was the, what was it?
The United States Tag Team title match. Yep, the United States tag match. The Midnight Express defended against Steve Armstrong and Tracy Smothers. I'm going to tell you, all five talents involved in this match are fucking amazing. Between Jim Cornette. I'm sitting there watching him and I'm laughing my ass off. I don't know how you, either you two feel about him. I know
you're saying what I feel. You are saying what I feel.
He's an acquired taste. Some people just cannot stand him because he's too old-fashioned, he's too traditional, but I agree with like 98% of what this fucking guy says, whether it be politics or wrestling.
Yeah. But,
and then the thing with this is, like, you really get to see fucking Stan Lane shine for some reason. It's like, it's been so long since I've watched Stan Lane wrestle a match because he fucking retired only a few years later that he was fucking amazing to watch. And Scott and Steve... excuse me, I'm sorry. Steve and Tracy, the Southern boys, are, you know, they even mentioned, I think JR mentioned that they had been teaming for like 3 years. They've basically been in Continental and wherever down south, but those dudes were very exciting as baby faces to watch. They really were that fucking good.
I loved everything about this match. And just you took the words out of my mouth. Yeah, I loved that match. So, well, when Ross referred to it as the coup de grace, it was with the drop kick off the rope that the Southern boys did. Mm-hmm. That was insane for the time. That was insane, and it made me
like,
Dan, how do you feel about this match, man? Like,
I loved it. You know, from beginning to end. Obviously, they had like that rush brawl in the beginning, and then they kind of changed the stance when it came to like wrestling into a karate stance standoff, which I thought was pretty funny and hilarious, especially with Stan Lane, you know, and I guess he has like a black belt background as well. Some of the kicks that Tracy Smothers was landing too. I would never knew somebody like him was capable of doing stuff like that. It was just, this match was very enjoyed, you know, big pops throughout the match. Even like two false finishes.
Yes.
That really hyped the match up.
Yeah, right. Those false finishes and the fans just made the match even better. And that's another thing we haven't touched on was the crowd. An amazing crowd for tonight.
All right, so this is what I wanted to say. You got a good point here, JJ. That while I was watching this, I thought that the crowd was kind of just like mild throughout the first, five matches. You know, I thought the crowd was kind of mild. It wasn't like exciting. Because remember, if we were watching Clash of the Champions last week, we reviewed that.
Yes.
In the entire fucking show, the crowd was wild. This was a little bit more mild. They were not as fucking crazy. But I mean, there's a 2-year difference and the product had changed somewhat. But it seemed like when this match came out, everything fucking changed for this show, and then the crowd got more into the fucking show, and it was just the Midnights, the Southern Boys, I think that seriously when the Southern Boys first came to the NWA, They're either wrestling the Midnight Express constantly or the Freebirds constantly. And so you knew you were going to get a fucking good match. Then they were usually on the opening match a lot of the times, too. So you knew that you were going to get, like, a fucking barn burner to get the crowd riled up.
That's so cool. Yeah. That is so cool. Well, we all. What about the finish? We got the. If it had a. I like the finish.
You got the kick in the head. I thought that that was nice. He got the kick in the back of the head, correct? And then he swiped him, and then went for the pin. It was it was good. I love tag team matches. You know, there's not a lot of there's not a huge tag team scene these days. But going back to this, you know, I could watch fucking hours of these two teams.
And I, you know what? I like the way they did that, though, because the Southern Boys, they did the whole switch rule, hoping that the referee wouldn't notice. Then Landbridge, the pin, he gets knocked out. Smothers tries to go to the top. He gets kicked in the head. Bobby rolls up for the win. It's a classic finish.
Yeah, I love the really finish. Everything they did to get to the finish, I love it. I love it.
It was
classic.
Awesome.
It's classic. And very classic. I loved it. If I had to rate it, I'd give it 5 super kicks. If I had to rate it, I don't rate man.
I don't rate shit. I don't use that 5-star Meltzer system. So
I'm nobody to rate anything. But
we're not making money off this. So, anyways, according to Jim Ross. Match number 7, it was the North American debut of Big Van Vader. That's a fucking lie. That's a fucking lie. I'm going to tell you that. Maybe the Big Van Vader character, but, you know, Leon White was wrestling in the AWA in the early 80s, so. I like how they try to trick the fans. Yeah. So he wrestled in the AWA. It's Baby Bull Leon White. Dan, I can only see half your head.
Yeah, I can only see your necklace. Yeah.
Maybe it'll come out better on screen. All right.
Yeah, hopefully. I knew that was screwy. I'm like, wait a minute. I'm like, no way. Vader's been, like, seen before. No way. And he wrestled the Z-Man.
The funny thing is, he gets squished in 2 minutes here.
2 minutes squash match, yeah.
Well, I'm going to tell you this. I bet you at that point, Tom had wished that he had stayed in WWF with that money. So, and that, you know, they were really pushing them as a tag team because it was like he came in and just got squished by a 400-pound man. And I had forgotten that Big Van Vader actually had that mask at one point. That was a full mask. Because then if you see in the future, he wears that, like, red strappy type mask. This was, like, a full mask with, like, the lightning bolts on it type thing. It's pretty interesting. I forgot all about it, but I did remember it from seeing it in Japanese videos and stuff.
I'm kind of sad that he stopped using the whole Mastodon helmet, kind of like the whole Japanese style helmet.
I think that had something to do with the fact that I think it was owned by All Japan. And they gave it to him, and he was able to bring it over here to the United States. I like how they're trying to sell it as it's like an ancient samurai like uniform, get up and stuff like that, and the whole thing. I'm like, the thing blows air and all this other shit. It's like it's all modern and technical and stuff. So I thought it was pretty comical.
Yeah.
So the match number 8, it's pretty controversial. I mean, with the crowd chanting an expletive at the Freebirds.
What was up with that attire? Like, you know, the fabulous Freebirds are looking like a 2002 Rico.
Yeah. There were times where they came out wearing those glittery tights, and it was just like, wow, you guys look.
I love this.
We'll say weird.
I love everything about it, about their outfits and the makeup. I love it.
I want to take a quote out of Michael Hayes that he said in one of his old WCCW promos. He, you know, Bubba bad to the bone. I don't know. He kind of looked soft there with the makeup and everything.
Yeah. Well, this is like this is the light version. This is like comparing, like, you know, it's like it really compared Miller High Life to like Miller Light. This is the Freebirds light. It's not really. A lot of people don't give Jimmy Garvin credit as part of the Freebirds. I always did because I thought him and Hayes worked well together. And he joined when the other two guys were still part of the team. But The WCW run, they did a lot of really corny stuff.
Like they were more really, glam? Yeah. Were they more glam? Okay. Yeah,
exactly.
You all know, right. It's like they were, all right. That, but I loved it because, yeah, I don't know. There's a little term called goth glam. So
I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying.
69 eyes. So yeah. I can lean toward that. I dug it. I dug what they were doing. Steiner's, I couldn't believe, were so young. And Scott Steiner was so agile and so... This is before he packed on 15 pounds of muscle. And,
is right around the time they were becoming the greatest tag team. So, and one of the greatest tag teams in the history of tag team wrestling. So they weren't really like packing it on there, like, doing a lot of the stuff that they ended up doing in the coming months, in the coming year, because they were still kind of getting it together as a team. Because I think they'd only been together less than a year. Because I think if I remember correctly, 1989, Steiner was he still breaking up from the Varsity Club and such around that time period? So they had only, it had only been probably like 8 months.
Around 8 months or
so. Yeah, so it's really? Like they weren't fully, I don't think that Rick and Scott were fully together even a year at this time period. But I'm going to say that Steiner had one of the greatest mullets in professional wrestling in this time period. So that is true. That is true.
I agree with you on that.
Talk about the foul language that was said in the crowd. So obviously, Rick, you know, me and you are kind of on the same side when it comes to hearing possibly the same words coming out of the fans' mouth, which I'm surprised that they weren't, you know,
they didn't try to get rid of it for the network edition.
Then again, I can't be surprised because if you watch like a lot of the old like ECW stuff, you hear the words "fuck," "shit," "bitch," all that. You know?
Those are not anything. Those are not anything. If anybody, I know JJ and Dan and I do not agree with this term, but to hear the crowd chanting "faggot" at the Fabulous Freebirds, I would not be agree with it because we do not. I was kind of laughing because, like I said, this is 1990.
Yeah.
Things were completely different then. And to hear this, I'm like, holy shit, I can't believe it. And it's, you know, and yeah. Obviously it's a way that they were trying to get the heels worked up, and it worked. Uh-huh. But I could not believe that
hear that today. Yeah. I couldn't believe that. I'm like, oh my God, like, that's where we were at.
I had to text Dan. I said, are they saying faggot? Like, and he was like, I think so. And I was like, holy shit.
I had to rewind it. Two times, I'm like, oh my God, they're saying faggot. I'm like, oh my God, like, my godfather would take me to wrestling shows, and my godfather is gay. You know, but he would take me to WWF shows, and that was when... that was during the Shawn Michaels Bret Hart time. But anyways, It's just like, oh my goodness, like
just showing where our country was at that time in 1991 or 1990, excuse me. We were not, I don't know. I guess it was regular behavior for the time. Not that we agree about it. Like I said, I've said this many times.
Well, just for a little bit of a history lesson, you know, going back around that time too. If you want to look back at like the pandemic of like HIV and like AIDS, like a lot of that stuff didn't have a name at that time, and you had a lot of famous people dying around that time. So when they looked at somebody like Freddie Mercury, by the time 1990 came along, you could already tell that his health was declining. You already know what he had without even saying it, because you knew the type of lifestyle that he lived.
And that ended up becoming a very like a derogatory term for they automatically, you know, back in the day, I know we're getting off subject, that they automatically thought that it was a disease between homosexuals, which was, you know, obviously very inaccurate. You know, they're just like, oh, like, if you had that, you must be gay. Like, it was just like,
shows how much we've evolved.
Yeah, it was...
We've evolved in the past few years.
Right. Thank and, you know, we've definitely, as a, I don't know, with our current political situation in this country, it doesn't seem like we're evolving much, but
no,
we're not going to talk. This is, this is a professional wrestling podcast, but, not a political podcast. However, we are allowed to express our opinions because this is a free fucking country. So, there you go,
the
gentlemen.
The next match was a, six-man tag, right? Am I right?
Yep.
That's what's next in my note.
The ill-fated dudes with attitudes, Ellie Gunn, Junkyard Dog, and Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. Yeah, came out wearing his white gear and that fancy-ass jacket. Took on the horsemen of Arn Anderson, Barry Windham, and Sid Vicious.
Let me tell you right off the bat, this match was the shits. I hated it. Bad match. JYD didn't sell shit. Orndorff was the only one in the match who was practically selling everything. And basically, just to end off the match, they were like, hey, we're just going to, you know, manhandle this guy 3-on-1, throw him over the top rope, and, you know, have those guys win by DQ. Because God forbid, that was an embarrassment. Hands down.
Right. So I'm wondering, it's like, you know, you really had the shits on one side of the, you know, with Ellie Gunn. Junkyard Dog was so far gone at that time from being the Junkyard Dog.
Yeah.
And, you know, Orndorff on that side was possibly still at that time one of the greatest wrestlers going, you know what I mean? So, I mean, he still
had another.
Yeah. He was awesome.
And I love what Barry Windham did in the ring. Barry Windham still tried, you know, to work. Same with Arn. Yeah, I love the crowd reaction.
I'm gonna tell you that. Arn is one of the greatest wrestlers in that time period. Oh, one thing that I forgot to mention. I want to step backwards a couple matches. I'm sorry. I forgot to mention. This is one of the things I wanted to bring up earlier during the Midnights and Stan Lane and Bobby Eaton, the Midnight and Southern Boys matches. Do you realize that the entire time the crowd is chanting for both teams, and the Midnight Express were over so much, and they were getting such a great crowd reaction as if they were baby faces the whole time. And I was just like, I was loving it. And I think that was like right when they decided to turn heel again, but they had a short baby face run in 1989 against the original Midnight Express. That's what I wanted to mention. I forgot to mention that earlier. We can get back
Right. So, they were. I didn't think about that.
Yeah. So I was watching that. And anyways, but the dudes with attitudes and the horsemen.
Yeah. I loved how the crowd was crazy for Sid.
That was so crazy because it's like not a lot of people really cared for him. And he wasn't going to be in here that much longer before he took off to go to WWE at some point for his first run. But he had some. I mean, Anderson, to my personal favorite, Arn Anderson's probably top two wrestlers. I keep switching between him and Benoit of all time. It all depends on my mood that day. But I think that, you know, he in that side, him, Arn, and Barry, like, really carried that fucking match. And Orndorff really carried that fucking match, like, the three of them.
And you know what? It pisses me off because we ended up getting a match like this, and Arn's title, which, you know, he was a television champion at that time, that was the only title that was not on the line that night.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah, well, because if you listen to JR's commentary, he announces that there's 5 title matches, and then during the first match, he corrects himself, saying, sorry, I thought there was 5. There was 4. The television title is not on the line tonight. So.
Yeah. And speaking of title matches, the next match was Lex Luger versus Mean Mark Callis, right?
I'm telling you, those two walking down the ring, the challenger and his manager, they were very familiar looking. I don't know who the fuck they were.
Oh, no. Rings to gongs. I mean, bells.
I love the belt that Lex had.
That version of the United States belt is a beautiful belt. But, you know, the thing with this is, like, Mark, Mean Mark, the Undertaker, whichever we want to refer to him as, is you tell he was definitely, you know, it was only probably like, I was talking to my wife about this because she came in when I was watching it, that it's only like 5 months away before he debuts at the Survivor Series.
Yeah.
Something like that. Because he debuted in 1990. Something like that. Yeah. I think it was November of.
Right. Yeah. November of 90. Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
Yep. So it's like, you know, but he doesn't seem like he seems a, how do I put this? He wasn't as good here as he was going to be when he went arrived in WWE in a few months, or WWF, excuse me.
But as you and Dan had stated, clash of, you know, there's a
clash of styles. Right.
Styles?
Yep.
Because, I mean, it's Lex Luger, you know?
Yep.
Kind of hard to match. You know, we talked about Lex having good matches with Brian Pillman, you know. But
I thought his when Lex, he wasn't necessarily the greatest wrestler, but when he was in the NWA / WCW from like 87 to like 91 or so, maybe 92, he had some really decent matches depending on who his opponent was, you know. And this match really isn't...
I expected more.
I thought that one of the things was that Luger got him in a torture rack. He didn't have it locked on properly, because he was just like, he had him like he was holding him over his shoulder like a fireman's carry, rather than having him laid out across.
But let me tell you though, that like the momentum that Luger got, you know, his momentum was all off of, you know, screaming clotheslines. You know, he's screaming throughout the whole match, hitting clotheslines on the Undertaker. And
that's how he beat him. Like, with the clothesline, I was like, are you serious? Like, I mean, you're beating a guy that's like twice your size with a fucking clothesline to the chest.
Yes.
That's it. Like,
yes. That's in my
one
notes.
One of the things is that
how big.
One of the other things that I forgot was that Jim Ross always used to refer to Paulie Dangerously as the psycho yuppie from Scarsdale, which I always loved that expression. It was always really funny.
I enjoyed something else I found funny.
Go ahead, Dan.
There's something else I found funny too. You know, like JR still going over the whole football background when mentioning Lex Luger and everything. But if you heard Paul Heyman on the outside, he was all like, I think he said something along the lines of, you know, you're not supposed to wrestle this good if you were a football player.
I didn't hear that.
I
did not catch that, Dan. Oh, my God.
So,
I didn't catch that. Yeah.
I got to tell you, you put the thing on during in the background. You're watching the show in the background as well?
Yes, sir.
Mine's on the same fucking match.
Oh, wow, that's weird.
So we must have both played it at the same time. So,
Dan, what are you doing, Dan?
What are you doing?
That's my catchphrase. Come on now.
Yeah.
That's why I said it.
Yeah.
I always try to put the event we're covering in the background just to kind of have it, keep it a little bit fresh, you know.
Speaking of background, you know, as soon as I got done with watching 1990 Great American Bash, it went right over to the next year. And, oh, my God, let me tell you, the quality on that, you know, the quality of that whole pay-per-view was just horrendous. It was horrible. Like, some of the commentary was cut off. Like,
yeah. That's something that we're going to have to do down the road, is definitely cover that. So, you know, because we already have a lot of stuff. As I text you guys both earlier today, we have like kind of a fucking heavy schedule ahead of us. Well, you know, like the dates for, you know, the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that we're not going to do random shit in the middle. So, bonus shit, because we are looking to do bonus stuff. Anyways.
We talked about.
I'm going to tell you something. The World Tag Team Title match: Doom, Ron Simmons against the Rock and Roll Express. The Rock and Roll Express have the opportunity to become, now, if I'm correct, he said the 5-time World Tag Team Champions here. Is that he had the opportunity?
Yeah. I think that's
this was a mismatch. You tell me, because it was like Rock and Roll Express are really old school for the time, like very 80s baby faces, and Doom are just two powerhouses that are just looking to fucking throw you around, kick the ever loving shit out of you. And I loved the tag team of Butch Reed and Ron Simmons as a team, whether they had masks, whether they didn't have masks, it doesn't fucking matter. They were just a fucking great team, I thought, and they definitely showed that here. The Rock and Roll Express just seemed to I'm kind of in the middle on this match. Like, it's kind of, it's all right. It would have been great on, like, a spot, like, on a spot show.
And I think some of the fans can sense that too, and maybe like some of the viewers who were watching at home at that time, because obviously a few months later at the next event, Halloween Havoc 99 or 1990, excuse me, you would have Rick Morton team up with Wildfire Tommy Rich against the Midnight Express.
That also had to do with Robert Gibson was out with a knee injury as well.
Right.
So Tommy Rich took a spot.
And then you got to probably like a couple months after that as well, you know, Ricky Morton would turn heel.
Yep. So. I remember. Well, yeah, that's definitely stuff down the road we got to talk about and bring into this, because there's definitely episodes. I remember that was at a Clash of the Champions, I think, if I remember correctly, Dan, where Ricky Morton turned heel. Richard Morton, excuse me. So
I just want to know how Butch Reed didn't become like a big, huge single star.
You know,
is there a reason?
That I can't answer. I know that he was in Mid-South in the earlier part of the 80s. And then, you know, I think, if I remember correctly, he made some appearances in World Class. And then he joined the WWF in around 1987 and left about 1988. And then he disappeared for a little bit, came over to WCW until, you know, and then, you know, formed with Doom. And then when they broke up, he kind of seemed to disappear after a little while, and then never really heard from again as like a full-time wrestler. I don't think I ever saw him on a regular basis anywhere.
Yeah, so, yeah, me too. And I always liked him. Like, something about him always stuck out to me. And I always thought, like, man, well, how come he wasn't a big, huge star, like a big single star? Ooh, yeah, that's going to put some hair on your chest. Yeah. And just took a shot of some whiskey. For those of you that
it was a shot of Highland Mist. This is, I don't know. I'm assuming this was some really cheap whiskey because it's in a plastic fucking bottle. So, you know, that's a sign of quality right there, gentlemen.
Doom did defeat
the Rock and Roll Express. Beat the Rock and Roll Express. I agree that, you know, Ron Simmons was the one that went on to superstardom in a way.
Yes.
Now that you guys brought that up, I think there was something else along the lines of, I'm not sure if it was JR, but they said they were the first Black African American tag team champions, maybe in that company.
Really?
But otherwise,
that's not a fact.
Well,
you know what? Yeah. You were right. They are the first National Wrestling Alliance Black African American tag teams because. What, 1983, 84? It was in WWF. Tony Atlas and Rocky Johnson were. Yep. You know what? I did not even catch that at the time. And, you know, I did know that answer. But I don't know how I didn't pick up on that when they said it. I'm watching. That's pretty interesting that you pointed that out there.
Yeah, very good. Very good. Interesting point. The next match was the main event.
Okay. I'm surprised at this match for some reason. Last week we wait a second. Okay. Last week we covered Clash of Champions where Ric Flair and Sting wrestled to a 45-minute time limit draw, and basically that match made Sting's career. Made him shot him into superstardom, and this match, how the fuck do you explain 2 years later Sting defeats Ric Flair for the world title in 16 minutes and 6 seconds? That's what I don't understand. I don't get that part. I remember as a kid, I was very excited at this result. But now growing up, I'm like, I think about the comparisons of 2 years earlier as a 45-minute time limit match. And today, you know, but he beat him in 16 minutes. One of the other things that... I loved about this was Sting's getup. He was very patriotic on this day.
Yeah, he
wore the legendary red, white, and blue getup, and I don't know, man. I really like the Surfer Sting. This version of Sting is my favorite. The Surfer Sting version, and it was when he became the Crow Sting that, my personal opinion, he wasn't as cool, man. He wasn't as cool, and he didn't wrestle as cool as good. Personal opinion.
Okay.
Yeah.
I enjoyed the match. I thought this was the match that made Sting only because the comment, you know, Ross And who else was the other commentator? I'm sorry, I forget.
Bob
Caudle. They kept putting over like how big this title match was and how important the belt was. And to me, it felt important. And is this Sting's first? Like, again, this is Sting's first title run.
Yep.
Yeah.
Is it? Okay.
Yes, sir.
So watching this would make me think like this is the match that put Sting in the superstardom. Just the casual thing.
And that's something that I told Rick too. Like this match basically just solidified Sting's career as like a main event superstar, but also like going on and carrying the company, saying, you know, Ric Flair basically saying like, "Hey, I trust you," you know.
Yeah, yes.
But one thing that pissed me off though was the finish, because if you guys noticed when Sting or Ric Flair was going for that knee in the turnbuckle, the cameras just went to the crowd. What the
hell?
Okay.
Yes.
I noticed I said, because I noticed that, and because I jumped up and I was like, what the fuck was that? I think that was, if I remember correctly, I don't think that was in the original. I think that was an edited version for the network. Something must have happened, and they just panned away from it. Because they've done that before on the WWE Network, because they fuck with shit, because it's the WWE Network. You know, anytime they get pissed off at something or something is not going right, they've gone in and then they've showed like fucking crowds. But you can definitely tell that if a crowd is just like, oh, that crowd is not from 1989. That looks like a modern crowd or some bullshit. They've done that shit before, and that's part of the fucking bullshit that WWE
does. Like rewriting history. I don't like that stuff.
But I did notice that happened too.
Yeah, I noticed that too. I was like, what the hell?
But the other thing with the finish is that he went for the figure four and then he just kind of gave him like a small package. I was like, well, that's it. I mean, I was like, I was expecting something longer and, you know, something bigger as far as the main event went. So I just found it strange. I mean, but it was a very fucking good match, because I think that anytime Sting and Flair stepped in the fucking ring together, it was pure fucking gold. The crowd was always fucking wrapped up in it as well.
Yeah, you're going to get a great match. I like that. It made it didn't make Flair look too weak, you know.
Right.
It left for more. Like, hey, Flair could be like, hey, you got lucky, you know. You got lucky because you rolled me up in a small package. I want my rematch.
One of the pre-match promos I think that Flair cut was possibly like, it was fucking intense and it was really good, you know. That guy could fucking cut a promo and. He was ready. He's like, I'm doing this, you know, and it was just awesome. God damn.
I enjoyed it. All in all, it was a good watch.
Yeah.
Good review. I love the card. And anything old WCW, I just love it. You know, for what it is, I love it.
Yeah, absolutely, man. I can't wait to do more with this. You know, I can't wait to watch more as we reveal. I don't think we have any WCW lined up. I don't have my schedule with me, but I don't think we have any others WCW lined up at the time.
Nope. For the time being. Next Sunday, we're going to the Land of Extreme. Isn't that right,
Rick? That's true. Yes, sir. Living Dangerously 2000, Danbury, Connecticut, at the O'Neill Center. And in an event that I was at, and I'm going to try to rack my fucking little brain to try to remember anything about being in attendance, because I was kind of it was kind of my partying days too as well, so I can't fucking lie about that. So yeah, we have a couple shows lined up, and don't forget the 18th and 19th, Dan and I will be back together. We're doing two shows for Impact and what's the other one? Oh, Extreme Rules. Are you in on that one, JJ? You'll be here.
That's
a Sunday. Say it's a fucking Sunday night, whatever. So,
Sunday night. Yeah, I'm in.
Yep. So,
Sunday night, I'm in.
Yeah, absolutely. Every Sunday night, Dan and Rick and JJ are here. And so that week, Dan and I have double duty. Actually, triple duty, because we got a regular Tuesday night show as well that week. So, yep. And all right, so we covered the Great American Bash 1990, one of the kind of oddball. I mean, this would not be a strange NWA/WCW event, because in the future, be a hell of a lot more stranger events that had happened in there.
Yeah.
So what else would you guys like to bring up?
Well, I mean, if you have any recommendations like we did last week and the week before, would you want to bring up recommendations or anything, or talk about that?
We'll talk about that stuff off air.
Off air, okay.
Yeah, but from what I understand, there's have you guys, I don't know if you, Dan, did you watch the Great American Bash?
I just got done watching it yesterday. I have not sat down to watch it yet. I mean, it definitely wasn't bad, but I thought the main event was good for what it was.
What was the main event for night one?
The main event was Sasha Banks taking on Io Shirai.
All right. From what I understand, that I saw the ratings. Now, I told you, I'm not a ratings person. I don't give two fucks about rating as long as the product is worth my watching. So... from what I understand, that was one of the only times that NXT had actually beaten AEW in the ratings because of that match. That's what I heard. I don't know how true that shit is, but
you know. I think there might have been like another time or so, but yeah, I think definitely that, like this past week.
Yeah. Yeah,
I know. But next Wednesday is definitely going to be something to look forward to because of the whole spoiler, I guess you would say, with the main event for next week. So I'm not sure if WWE...
Well, I don't know. JJ, did you hear about this spoiler? I don't know how close that...
I did hear about some wrestler leaked a spoiler through their Instagram story.
Yep. And you know, it was for the NXT title.
Double title match.
But an article came out probably the next day after Dan sent that to me that there may have been, not guaranteed, two finishes filmed. So I guess we're just going to have to fucking find out Wednesday what actually happens and which version that they air. And if it's true, I am extremely excited. If the title change is true, I'm going to be extremely excited because the gentleman that wins the title, let's just say it, Keith Lee supposedly wins the title. Off Adam Cole, and Keith Lee is one of my absolute favorites of the modern era in the last couple of years. So,
he's exciting.
Yeah, he's very exciting for a guy his size. I think he's probably about the same size as myself. And he, if they actually do show that, I'm going to be very excited because, I've popped a few times watching this guy, especially his series with Dijakovic. They've done some good matches. They've wrestled a few times in Northeast Wrestling. It's too damn Dijak and Keith Lee. Sorry.
Yeah, I was there for one of those.
Were you? Okay.
Yeah, it was over the top scene.
Yes. Yep. They've done one match there. Yep.
I remember that day because that was the day I met Ricochet, and that was like the only reason why I went to that event.
Right. Was he still with Ring of Honor at the time period?
I think Dijak was still a part of Ring of Honor, and then Keith Lee was a part of Ring of Honor too, but I know he was doing like PWG shows and Evolve.
Right.
And Ricochet, I think he was still a part of Lucha Underground because Sammy Callahan was at that show.
This is a Northeast show Sammy Callahan had come out for?
I missed this shit. 2017, January of 2017, over the top.
Jesus, all right. I don't pay enough to
and that
I
was
go
that
to
was
Northeast the events, event. But I don't pay enough attention.
That was the same event Michael Bennett won the over the top Rumble match, and that's when he would face TKO Orion for the title at WrestleFest about like a month or two later in the same not the same venue, but the same area.
Right. That's pretty cool, man. So what else, JD? What else do you got going on there?
What do I have going on?
Yes, sir.
As far as
professional wrestling news.
Oh, professional wrestling news? Anything? Well, I love professional wrestling news. I've just been watching a lot of old WCW Saturday night. I've been watching World Class. Yes, I tried watching some AEW. Not AEW. What was it? AWA. Yes.
AWA.
Last week, you had recommended me watch some AWA, and I believe sometime maybe Monday or Tuesday night, I watched a couple episodes of it.
What did you watch? Stuff on the network?
On the network, yeah. I don't remember what it was AWA wise, but I do remember watching. It was World Class and oh my goodness, who was in the first match? It was somebody with is there a David Von Erich?
Yep, he was the okay. He was the guy they were supposed to put the NWA title on, but then he died.
Was a match with David Von Erich and somebody else. I can't remember who it was, but fun match. I loved it, and I kept on watching it, and I remember just falling asleep to it a couple days ago. I didn't fall asleep to it because it was boring. I fell asleep to it because I got tired and I wasn't really feeling
100%. It was the wrong time of day to put it on. Exactly. I get you.
At night. Yeah, it was at night at about midnight, 1 o'clock, in the morning.
I need some recommendations from you, gentlemen. What should I be watching these days?
Oh, boy. Besides NXT, Ring of Honor, or are we just talking like...
I go freelance wrestling. Freelance.
I've seen some freelance stuff on... I subscribe to independentwrestling.tv, and they're on there. And I enjoy them from what I've seen. I have enjoyed them. They're from out your way, right? In Indiana?
In Chicago.
Chicago, sorry. Yeah, drew a blank. They're from out there, right? I should fucking go out there for the show. I should go out
there for the show. I enjoy anything freelance and anything Warrior Wrestling.
Yep, I've seen Warrior Wrestling as well.
Yeah, I recommend any of that. And good people at Warrior Wrestling. I remember I told you they gave me a press pass for Warrior Wrestling 6 or 5. I forgot what it was. Obtained the press passes. It's good people, man. Warrior Wrestling treated me very good. So
let me ask you. Recently, a picture of you has been making the rounds with said former WCW superstar used in a video. Why don't you tell everybody and Dan about that event?
Okay. I don't mind. Okay. Well, a friend had notified me a couple days ago, Thursday morning. He had notified me that he saw a picture of me from my interview with Buff Bagwell that I did a few years ago on a video by Wrestling Bios, a YouTube channel that I am a fan of.
Oh my God, I watch those guys.
Yes, you watch them too. I watch them too. I love the guy's voice. I don't know what country he's from, but I love his accent. I love all his what is it? He does a series of Monday Nitro versus Monday Night Raw series. I watch his channel. The channel's been active for about a year and a half. And I don't know if it's a team or how many people, but he used a screenshot of me and Buff, of a picture of Buff and I, for a Buff video, and used it in his video. And I didn't know that until 3-4 days ago, and it just boggled my mind. It humbled me knowing that, okay, this dude took the time to watch my interview and took a screenshot of it. Wow.
So is the interview that you did with Bagwell up on YouTube, or where is it?
Yes, sir. Yeah, it's on my YouTube page. Yes, it's on my YouTube page.
The JJ Sin. Why don't you tell everybody here?
And it's on my YouTube page, and you can watch that interview with me, Buff, and I. It was at JJ Sin. JJ S I NNZ, make sure you put a space bar between the JJ and the Sin, because that's the only way I'll come up. So JJ space bar Sin. I'm serious. JJ space bar Sin. I'm serious. People have like, I can't find it. I can't find it. I'm like, well, you got to put a space bar between the two J's and the Sins. That's how it, yeah.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
Dude, that's but awesome. Under,
thank you. Yeah, it is. It was. It blew my mind. I was like, holy crap. I love it. I love this channel. And it just made
I've seen it before, and you messaged me saying that. And I was like, yeah, right. And so then, of course, I went and watched it, and I said, this JJ. It looks just like that with the hat and the, you know, and you know, Marcus that's Alexander Bagwell.
Wow. Yeah, Buff Bagwell just, yeah. So that was cool. It was humbling. I was like, wow, that's so cool. And I felt bad because the video came out 6 months ago, maybe 7 months ago. Yeah, and I had watched it, but I listened to it. I didn't watch it because I was driving to work listening to it. And I felt bad. I didn't, you know, the way, you know, I found out so late, but.
Right.
I do watch his videos, though. I do, you know.
Just don't watch while you're, you know.
While I'm driving. Sure I know. Yeah.
Yeah, just be careful there. We don't want to lose a member of our team.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't want to ever do that. So, I'll just, you know, watch when I'm not driving.
Yes, there's a lot of, I just lost the page. There was a Northeast Wrestling event coming up in August 15th, Dan. And if I remember correctly, and here it is. It's the Bethany Town Hall. There's no talent listed for it yet. So I don't know if it's going to be indoors or outdoors.
Maybe it'll be in this case, I would love to see it outdoors, you know.
Yeah. At least we'd be able to get to see a live wrestling event again, you know.
Yeah, right.
It's outdoors. I know it was a wrestling.
You know what? I mean, I wouldn't even mind, Rick. You know, maybe you and I maybe could team up and stuff like that. Maybe do like a live video. You know, maybe get a few connect.
That's so cool. I wish I was in Connecticut.
It's supposedly August 15th, 7 o'clock, 7 to 10. So I'm watching this closely on their Facebook page to see if anything changes. As of right now, it's still going on. I know there's a couple shows. I know. Paradise Alley has had a couple shows scheduled for September. I think one was at the fairgrounds. I think that already got canceled. I think it was like part of Taco Fest. But according to the Facebook page, the show in Woodbridge, I don't know if you've ever been out that way, Dan. It's not too far from where you are. That show is still on as of present moment. It's at the JCC. And I went to the one last year that they did at the JCC. It's a nice venue. It's about 3 to 4 minutes from where I grew up. I grew up like 2 blocks from there, and it's a really nice building. So I usually take part in a Scrabble tournament there every year through work. It's just a very nice building.
Cool.
So I'm hoping that that event takes place. So there's two shows that we can.
Go ahead.
There's just, you know, a couple shows there that are listed that, I'm hoping actually do take place because I'm itching to get out to a live event. I really am.
I feel you. Oh, I feel you on that.
I'm guessing while we're here, I might as well share some of the recent pickups from my Independence Day unboxing, I guess you would say, as I quoted them on YouTube.
I think you're going to like this stuff, JJ. I don't think I have anything coming in for like a while. I think I finally am caught up outside of like my loot boxes. What's today's date? The 5th?
Fifth. Yeah.
So they usually come around the 13th or so, right? So I think
I'm waiting on that for wrestling loot. I did get a nice pin in the mail, but I'd have to look for it.
Well, all right. So go ahead, man. Why don't you share this stuff?
Let me reveal some of these things here now. Rick, JJ, you guys know how much I passionately talk about Demolition.
That's my favorite tag team.
But I ended up getting the Micro Brawlers.
Ooh! Oh, that's so cool.
I believe what was it? High Spots was selling them on their gimmick table last Saturday, or the Kitchen auction that they had, like one or so. And I believe they were going. Those guys. I think they were going around like the same price, like 20 or so, 25. But I ended up getting them for a good, reasonable $20.
For both of them?
Yeah. So.
And that was on High Spots.
No, these actually I got off of an eBay seller. So.
Okay.
But coming to High Spots, let me all right, Smash, you're just gonna fall. Let me just look for the DVDs I picked up this past week.
I that Demolition is my favorite tag team. I don't know if you know that, Dan.
They're not Tony and Art, I'm just telling you.
They are. They're my favorite tag team. They're the best tag team, and I got a little shrine to Demolition in my foyer.
So, going on with the DVD pickups, you guys know how I love my RF shoot interviews and whatnot, but let me see, how would I start this? Yeah, let's start from the bottom here. So, first one I got here is Sean Waltman, because hear a lot. Yeah, I mean, I've seen the Click documentary that WWE aired, but I really want to know a lot more about him, like how we grew up, and
Go ahead, so keep going.
Basically, just growing up in Minnesota, he had great chemistry with Jerry Lynn growing up as well. So I really want to get in detail with their feud as well, because I thought they had some phenomenal matches, and you know. Making his way from like Japan, WWE, and you know,
Waltman is one of my all-time favorite wrestlers. Like,
I love Sean. Funny story, I met Sean. I probably told you guys this story before, but I had met Sean at the Rhode Island Comic Con in 2018, and he was, I believe, the second wrestler I met that day. And I was probably like first or second person in line, you know. Welcomed me with open arms and everything. Oh, hey, kid, how are you? I told him,
he's really cool.
Run it by history, he doesn't even know about it. Like, oh, let me just run it just in case. And it was so funny, too, because he brought his dog with him, and I'm with my boy. He's like, you want to pet my dog? And sure. And we ended up taking three pictures with each other, doing three different poses of like DX, NWO, whatnot. After all of that, me and my boy left his booth. My boy's looking at, he taps me on the shoulder real quick. He's like, dude, you know he was giving you a dirty look if you didn't pet his dog?
Oh, I think you did tell me that.
And I felt so bad because I was like, well, I was going to pet his dog anyway. I mean, I know, you know, but anyway, that happened. But going on with the next shoot interview DVD, I actually picked up Kurt Angle. So, I mean, he's been brought up a couple times in like WWE docs.
Back. That would be a good interview, you know.
Next one I picked up is something that me and Rick discussed this past Wednesday on the Impact review, and somebody that we questioned, like, why he never made it, you know? And he was a former tag team partner of The Undertaker and WCW as the Skyscrapers.
Yeah, I
think that's a great grab, and I want to hear about this shoot. I've seen clips of it. Dan Spivey, I think that is always one of those guys that should have been way bigger than he actually was. You know, as Dan stated that, did he say that today or maybe in a conversation we had that he basically retired because he had a bunch of nagging injuries. But, you know, I thought he was a great character as a heel, like a psychotic heel.
Wayland Mercy stuff. Character?
Yeah, and then Wayland Mercy, but, you know, in the NWA, probably in, 89, 90. But he also, you know, prior to that, he was the golden boy, Dan Spivey, WWF. He formed the new U.S., the new U.S. Express with Mike Rotunda, because Wyndham was not in there anymore.
Right.
So anyways, but I'd be interested in seeing that. That looks like a good shoot.
And guys, yeah. You know, we were just talking about this gentleman too. You guys want to know more about Butch Reed? Well, I got your answer right here with the shoot interview. So he'll definitely go in depth with. Oh wow, he actually encountered the KKK. That's not all right. Yeah, I'm definitely gonna have to watch.
You know, it's definitely sounds like something you got to watch now. But it's funny that you said that he encountered the KKK. I remember I was reading like an old story about like Dusty Rhodes and he was friend, you know, him and Dick Murdoch were tag team partners and in the 70s or whatever. And it was like he asked Dick Murdoch one day, I think this might have been later on, though, asked him for a ride somewhere. And he ended up giving him a ride out into the woods. And then it ended up being into like some fucking KKK rally or some bullshit.
Yeah, I've heard that story. Yeah.
And you know, me, I was like a huge fucking Dick Murdoch fan when I was a kid. And I thought he was fucking great. You know, he was like this great redneck, but he could fucking kick the shit out of you. And when I heard that, I was like, what the fuck? I was like, you know.
And I've heard that story more than once.
Yeah, all right. So it's not that crazy. Yeah, all right.
You're not crazy. Yeah.
Going on with the last three DVDs. Rick, I kind of blame you for this one because once
most likely it is my fault.
I mean, once I that pickup, I was like, let me see what they got for this territory, and they had a shitload. So I was like, all right. And I had just got recently done watching the Jerry Lawler documentary that WWE put out a couple years back, and I was like, damn, now I really have to pick these up. But I got a couple. Memphis wrestling DVDs. So got one here with goes over Jerry Lawler versus Andy Kaufman. That should be interesting. Got the same one that Rick just picked up, the best of Eddie Gilbert. So that one's gonna be interesting. And then kind of a curveball here. I mean, I know a lot of people don't like him. I mean, in some aspects I do.
Who's this?
Champion with Owen Hart. The best of Jeff Jarrett.
I'm a huge Jarrett fan, man. I don't understand all the hate he gets. I've always loved Jarrett.
Well, so. I think it's definitely it's different. You know, I think that a lot of people. Sorry, guys, I went and got a box of stuff I wanted to show y'all. I know
I'm acquired tape.
Yeah, I think he's an acquired taste, like you said. But there's also that he was the promoter's son. Where the fuck am I back?
Yeah.
Okay. He was the promoter's son. That's one thing that did not go over well. So he was automatically pushed to the moon. I think that my personal opinion, he did not click with the mainstream crowd when he came into WWF and WCW. Personal opinion. I always enjoyed him, and he probably deserved more credit in the mainstream audience than he actually got. So I always enjoyed Jared. I always thought since I saw him, the first time I saw him in probably like 86, 87, whenever he fucking debuted in Memphis, that he was always a really great wrestler. And when he came to WWF, when they were using Memphis at the time, I thought that they were doing the interpromotional thing. Of course, they were mentioned more on USWA than they were mentioned on WWF TV. That I was very happy for him, and I got excited because I got to see him on WWF TV on a weekly basis, and I thought that was a great thing.
That's cool.
Let's go on main event now. I got two autographs also. So
one of them. I'm completely jealous of one of these autographs. I'm just.
I got three autographs.
I have a shirt in this box. Go ahead. I want to show you some DVDs I got. I don't know. JJ, were we talking not so long ago? Do you still purchase physical media?
Oh, like DVDs?
Such as DVDs, CDs, all that bullshit.
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Go ahead, Dan. Before I show off my shit.
So, going on with the autographs, I'll start off with the first 8x10s, the first two 8x10s. One of them who was brought up tonight, Lex Luger with the NWA.
That's cool.
So pretty cool.
I actually got a Lex autograph too, as well, recently. I don't know if you saw that video. Sorry to cut you, Dan. I don't know if you saw my Lex autograph that I got, JJ. Did you see that one?
The video that you put up.
Go ahead, Dan, and I'll grab my Lex autograph while you guys are going off.
Going on with the next one. Once again, another name that I brought up not too long ago. You know, continuing on with the patriotic theme here of the unboxing reveals and things. But I got Kurt Angle here from WrestleMania 19.
Oh, that's badass.
That's cool. Definitely better than the other one I have. I mean, it's just a, you know, 8x10, just him with a, you know, like a big green background, obviously, but it's all good. But
I'm going to tell you, I enjoy these Sunday evenings where we just fucking drink and fucking shoot the shit on the podcast. So sorry to our listeners that we're like a little bit buzzed. So
the last thing I got here is definitely a treasure. I only paid like $40 for this, but I figured, you know, my God, you know, gotta stay patriotic, you know, 4th of July. So let me pick this up. And, you know, I'm not really a big collector of like pops like that. I mean, I have one Ric Flair pop from the 2K19 pre-order. So I was like, all right, let me get that. But this one's special. And that's Sergeant Slaughter.
That's a sweet ass Funko Pop. That's a nice.
And it's autoed, fucking A.
I don't collect Funko Pops. I know they're all the rage with a lot of people, especially wrestling fans for some reason. The wrestling. Do you? Why am I not surprised? But you know.
Because I'm young.
Wow, you're really not that much younger than me. But you know, I used to have a bunch of Walking Dead Funko Pops at one point. So. And, you know, I ended up getting rid of them. But some of the wrestling ones, I just don't care about them that much. They're not as cool as, like, regular figures. Not that I even collect figures. I don't collect figures, but, you know. I ended up getting a Lex autograph myself as well.
Oh, my God, that's so cool.
The Lex Express. There's a certificate of authenticity. I know I shared it on one of my recent videos. I don't remember what. But Dan got that Memphis DVD. I ended up getting a whole stack of these fucking Memphis DVDs. I'm about to fucking go sick watching this shit because I love Memphis.
I blame you.
It is my fault because I told Dan I bought... Oh, shit. I bought like five of them. Yeah, I bought like five of them. And then Dan, next thing I know... Dan is like, oh, I bought this one and this one. But one of the things is that Dan and I have agreed on in the future, we're going to have to do a review of the best of Eddie Gilbert in Memphis. And we're definitely going to be doing that. So, and, you know, Eddie Gilbert, I think, is one of the greatest fucking professional wrestlers of all time. And it's so very sad that he died at such a young age. And he was such a fucking great wrestler. He had a great mind for the business. And he was a great promoter. I'm sorry, I'm rambling on. And, you know, him, when in the earliest fucking days of the ECW, he was lighting that shit on fire, dude. Like, I'm telling you. And I think that that's what helped get attention in the NWA Eastern Championship Wrestling before it was Extreme.
I got to start watching Eddie Gilbert then. Is there any Eddie Gilbert on the network?
There's got to be. There's got to be.
There's got to be, right?
You'll probably see, like, a bunch of WCW stuff. I don't even honestly know what the fuck is on the network anymore because I don't pay. Like, I have not gone through it unless we were agreeing to.
But YouTube is our friend. Yeah.
YouTube is our friend. I'm going to tell you something. Look up the Eddie Gilbert Lawler feud, Jerry Lawler feud, and you can see where he runs over fucking Jerry Lawler with the fucking car. That's the fucking greatest thing ever. I'm going to totally have to put a parental warning on this episode because we've dropped so many F-bombs tonight. or maybe I did. I don't know. But either way. So, but that's, you know, I'm having fun. But whatever. But yeah, Eddie Gilbert, you can definitely type in his stuff in Memphis, his stuff in Continental, all that shit, dude, and Puerto Rico. So I highly recommend watching a lot of, you know, I love wrestling from Puerto Rico, like WWC and IWA Puerto Rico. So you're gonna find a lot of really cool stuff on Eddie Gilbert if you look up those three promotions.
I'll definitely do that. Definitely.
Or what you could do, I mean, on High Spots, they also have a compilation set of the best of Eddie Gilbert and ECW. I think it's like a 2 or 3 disc set for like $20. So that'd in definitely
where?
Be
in, your investment. Where?
High Spots. It's
in ECW? High Spots?
Yeah.
I wonder what ECW stuff they're distributing. Because as far as the three of us, like, it's all owned by WWE. So
right.
I know that RF.
Well, that's RF the Vigo thing.
Did a bunch of fan cam footage, and they own the rights to the fan cam footage because they filmed it themselves. So I'm wondering if that's the footage. I mean, I have a from High Spots through the Pro Wrestling Crate DVD of Cactus Jack and ECW. So I'm wondering if that's like the same, like if it's fan cam footage or something. I don't know if like maybe I don't know if maybe well, High Spots released the footage.
I know some of the RF videos that they release of like the ECW pay-per-views. They're all unedited. They're all the original, you know, all the original footage.
Those gotta be bootleg, man. Because I mean, as far as
they're IRS.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he was the king of the bootleg DVD back in, you know, or VHS and DVD back in the day. So I don't know what's going on with that stuff. Like as far as like the you know, who and whatever the fuck it's called. Sorry, I kind of spaced out there. I'm drunk. I'm sorry. So
this is our regular
Sunday night.
You know, I am drunk.
We're having a good time. So, you know. Anyways, I want to see. You know, I want to watch that. Did you get the Cactus Jack and the ECW thing, Dan? The DVD from High Spots that was actually in the Pro Wrestling Crate. Did you order that one?
I haven't. I have seen it on eBay, so okay. I might pick it up on eBay sooner or later.
I have it.
You have it too. Yeah, I'm sure JJ has it. I have not. I have yet to watch it. Some of those matches I don't ever remember, so I don't even know if they aired on. Like, I'm pretty sure it's fan cam footage from RF or some bullshit that they. Because I know RF. Sold a lot of stuff to High Spots. Sold a lot of their original content that they created as far as that stuff and shoot interviews. So that's all that bullshit. So what else we got here, gentlemen? We've been talking a long time and I'm having fun.
Yeah.
I'm not necessarily even concerned about leaving.
About the what?
About ending. I'm not even concerned. I had my buddy on the other day. We just were shooting the shit about wrestling. And I seriously could have gone a full 2 hours just fucking shooting the shit.
Oh,
so,
shit.
Yeah.
That's what we've gone. We've gone about
an hour and a half.
Almost 2 and a half, yes.
Yeah. So what else we got, gentlemen?
The recent Impact possibilities with Heath Slater dropping that video. July 8th.
From what I understand, he's confirmed now, as of today. That's what I hear. I read some article that Heath Slater is confirmed. I read an article that Gallows and Anderson have signed officially, but they're also signed to New Japan as well, so they're going to be bouncing back and forth.
And then there's a slight possibility of Leo Rush. I'm not sure if you checked that video that I sent
yes,
you.
Yes, I did check that out. So there's a possibility of him, and there's a possibility of a lot of motherfuckers. And there was something that Dan sent me, a few days ago, that it's very possible that Curt Hawkins and Matt Cardona, Curt Hawkins, what the fuck is his real name? Brian Myers and Matt Cardona are going to be popping up as well. I seriously
think
people are not paying enough attention to Impact Wrestling. And it's the promotion to watch. And I think that Slammiversary in 2 weeks is going to launch that Dan and I have been talking very positive about them for like the last month since we started doing our Tuesday reviews.
About a month?
Yeah, it's kind of has to be, right? Maybe 3 weeks, 4 weeks. So
about that. Maybe, close enough.
Yeah, it's got to be close to a month. But I think that it's people. I think that the pay-per-view is it's gonna confirm everything that Dan and I have been saying for the last fucking month. But I think that they have not been getting enough attention. They have an amazing fucking roster. They've been putting on solid fucking TV shows for weeks. And I think that with the recent releases from WWE in April, once the pandemic started, all these guys, a lot of these gentlemen are going to be jumping over to Impact, and a bunch of them are pretty much fucking firm. Did I just say that Heath Slater was confirmed? I know I read the article earlier. I don't know if I said it to you guys. I'm sorry. I rambled.
Well, I know I saw that article earlier that basically just said that Heath Slater was confirmed, that he was going to be in a tag team with Rhino. And I did see the video, basically just him.
And there's rumors. I mean, EC3 has been putting out some weird fucking videos. He has hinted at both Impact and AEW. I don't know if the AEW hints are just to throw people off. But as we stated, it was the last week or the week before, there was the fucking Moose match and the fucking his music fucking hit. So we're gonna have to. We're like, I can't wait until the 18th because I will. I'm actually thinking about paying for the shit. I never pay for a fucking pay per view outside of the WWE Network. Oops, I'm sorry. I just said that live in person. Oops. I never find an illegal stream. I swear to God, I don't. For every pay-per-view. So anyways, I'm actually thinking about purchasing it and watching it in full, not have to fucking get the feed interrupted. And I think it's going to be a fucking, like I've been saying for a long time, Impact is a sleeper promotion. You know, not enough people are paying attention to them. They're getting back on track. They need something to get the people to suck the masses back in. Suck the people, exactly. Because you realize, like, it's weird because ever since I got bought out by Anthem, even before Dan and I started doing the show on Tuesday nights, they were only drawing, I don't know how many people to their TV tapings, 500 or whatever. It's empty. They used to drive something like, they used to do a couple thousand to 5,000 people. You know what I mean? So it was pretty, they used to do pretty big fucking crowds, whether it was Universal Studios, but I think that they didn't even charge for the fucking, but for some of their live events, they used to do a few thousand people. So I think this event is going to draw people back into this shit. So hopefully into the promotion, because I think that they're bringing in, and if I'm correct at the people that I think that are coming in, I think it's going to work. Personally, I think it's going to work. I think that Impact has been putting on solid shows for the last month and a half, 2 months, and I know Dan and I have only been doing the shows for about 3-4 weeks. But I think that it's going to be that they're just an amazing product that people aren't necessarily watching, that they need to fucking turn around and start watching again.
Yeah, really think about it too. I mean, especially with this episode coming up on Tuesday, you know, starting at 9 of 8. So you must think they have hype before the pay per view.
Yeah. I'm wondering if that's going to be a permanent change or if it's just for this week. I hope it's just for this week because I'm not going to want to be. So Dan and I know last week we altered our recording of that until Wednesday. I think we're going to do that again this week because of the time that they decided to change the fucking schedule. Not me. Not us this time.
A couple bathroom bloopers, but, you know, that's okay.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you want to bring that up again, don't you? I ended up having to edit three pieces in together. What's up, JJ? You got something to say, it looks like.
Well, I didn't want to say I'm getting, like, massive text messages right now. Usually we run about an hour, hour and a half. I'm like getting text messages. People know that right. Phone. Should we wrap this up or?
Sure. Let's wrap it up. Why don't we wrap?
I don't want to be a jerk, but I got.
You could always press the exit button and.
I wouldn't dare do that. That'd be rude, but yeah, I keep getting text messages like, hey,
All right. So, JJ, before you go, why don't you hit the? Why don't you tell everybody how to get in touch with you, JJ?
Oh, just double J, SINNZ. yeah, JJ Sins. That's how you can reach me on Snapchat, YouTube, and the Instagram and the Twitter. But I'm more active on Snapchat, so get at me.
Why is that, JJ?
It's easier.
Well, as I always explain to JJ, is this because he's a teenage woman, a teenage girl, because he's on Snapchat so much. But anyways, as a joke, you know.
As a, yeah, no, it's Snapchat. It's easier just to get a hold of me. I'm always on Snap. It's easier to share stuff. It's easier to, you know, like, if I want to, like, talk to you, I can just send, like, a video, like, hey, like, babe, we got to do this, do that, and then do this, and then I'm going to do that. It's so simple than just sending a text.
I have no idea about Snapchat. I've never used Snapchat, you know. It's
so much easier to share.
I do use Facebook because they have groups, like, you know, like, what the fuck name is called? Like, forums and bullshit. Yeah, stuff like that. So, you know, and I use that with the podcast, and I use Twitter mainly and Instagram. Those two I use to promote the podcast mostly. Outside of that, I don't really fucking, you know, once in a while I'll post some random junk. But all right, JJ.
Yeah.
I'll talk to you soon, sir.
Okay. Bye, Dan. What do I do? Do I just hang up?
Hit the red button. Click your screen, and then the hang up button should pop up there.
Hold on. I don't want
You're supposed to be. You're not gonna fuck anything up. Just hit it.
All right. All right, Dan. Everybody, motherfucking Rick. Love you both.
I'll talk to you tomorrow, brother.
All right, bye, brother.
I'll see you. Bye. Love. Much love to you. Bye. All right. Red button. I'm clicking the red button. Bye.
Hang up. Goodbye. And he's gone. Jesus Christ. All right, that was a lot of fun. That was a blast. Anyways, Dan, you still there? Dan?
Yeah. Okay.
All right, there you go. All right. You disappeared. You froze for a second there.
Oh, no. I'm good. Yeah, you know what? Might as well keep going. Yeah, no. Let's keep going.
You know, I'm all about it. We still got... You know, I can go for about another 40 minutes. What time we got here? Oh, dude, yeah, I can go for another few minutes.
Okay. So anyways,
what were we talking about before Dan decided, I mean, not Dan, you're Dan, JJ decided to be a teenage girl. What was it?
We were just talking about the Impact show, just basically.
Like we said, and, you know, I've said this every week to you since we started covering Impact, that Impact is basically the most underrated wrestling product on a television, you know, on a television basis that currently. It's upsetting in a way. They had a big following, but they also created a terrible name for themselves over the year throughout the Dixie Carter years and Vince Russo years and all that stuff. So, you know, and then when they sold the Anthem finally, it's just going to take a long time for them to get back on track. And especially this year, especially, you know, when they were on Pop TV and then they lost the Pop TV deal.
Yeah.
And then they went to, where did they go after that? Oh, they lost the TV deal for a while. They were strictly on Twitch for a little while. And then they went to Pursuit, which was owned by the same company, I believe.
Yeah.
So they went from Pursuit to eventually they end up on Access, which was a pretty big deal. However, I still don't get Access TV, so I get Twitch. I just watch them on Twitch because I don't get I don't get any of the channels that they've been on. I did get Pop for a while. So, shit. They lost their luster for a little while, but they're really getting on the right track. And I think that with all these recent WWE releases, I've stated a few times, especially tonight, I've stated a few times that they're getting back on track. And maybe they can get to that, especially when this pandemic is over, that they can get back to when everything was normal and start bringing in big crowds, big ratings, and all that sort of shit.
Yeah, I think TNA is doing the right thing. They're capitalizing on the opportunities, And they're just looking for a way to just rebrand themselves. Obviously, the whole Dixie Carter era, Vince Russo era, didn't really pan well towards the end or beginning of, like, the early, you know, 2010s going forward.
Right.
So I think this is, like, a proper way, even just, like, reminiscing to, like, WCW, how NWA, you know, moved on from NWA and moved to, you know, WCW once Ted Turner bought the promotion. I mean, obviously, it kind of went a different direction, but it was still different. It still drew people. So in a way, I think it should be the same concept with Impact. I mean, obviously they're doing all these certain types of things with it, whether it's like Impact, possibly bringing back the TNA name. Obviously
we've seen definitely a possibility. So like to bring back the TNA name. They've definitely been hinting at it for a very long time. So and now, especially more so since they've been bringing what's-his-face in, Moose as the end of, Impact World Champion.
Yes.
So, which I think is interesting. I mean, I don't necessarily hate the idea of them doing that, really. I guess they could have just done it, better, but, you know.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. It just the whole thought of just Moose. I'm just not a big Moose guy. You know, I like chocolate Moose. I like Moose tracks, but Moose the wrestler, I'm just not.
For some reason, I think you're lying because from what I understand, you do have a Moose T-shirt in your collection.
Listen. That was the tote bag's fault. You know, randomized tote bag, brown bag special, whatever the fuck they call it now. They just said, hey, listen, we're going to give you not one. No, I think it was just one Moose T-shirt and then like a John Hennigan T-shirt that's like based out of Canada. And I'm not even Canadian. And I have nothing against Canadians.
Hey, no. But I am partially Canadian. Don't offend me.
No pun intended. Hey, I know. But I don't know. Just two random T-shirts. I wasn't expecting those T-shirts. I was expecting something better. And as soon as I saw the Moose T-shirt, I'm like, you bitch. Like, all right.
Well, let me tell you something. I've ordered many grab bags. You know that I order a lot of grab bags. I've gotten several T-shirts that I fucking hated. One of them was an Orange Cassidy T-shirt, and I ended up fucking turning around and selling it because I fucking hate that guy. I think he's like a shit stain on the wrestling industry. So, I don't know what your opinion on him is.
I have mixed feelings about him. Like, I think he's entertaining, but when it comes to his wrestling, it's kind of just like, like, I'm not a big fan of it.
All right, so I'm going to be honest. In the last few months, I've come around a little bit over couple of years of absolutely hating the fucking gimmick, hating him, and I have actually come around a tiny bit. I'm not going to say that I'm a fucking fan yet. I will definitely not wear his fucking T-shirt. Somebody was watching one of my unboxing videos, a friend of mine, and saw me get the Orange Cassidy shirt, and I was fucking furious. I was pissed, and they texted me automatically. It's like, you were so funny when you realized you had an Orange Cassidy shirt. I was fucking heated. The guy is more than capable. Because I've seen him do things in the ring. It's the gimmick that annoys the fuck out of me. It's the gimmick and, you know, stuff like that. It just annoys the fuck out of me. But the guy is more than capable of doing shit. The pockets thing is annoying. I'm sorry. I'm a Cornette guy till I die. So you know, I'm gonna stick with the more traditional style of things. I'm sorry, everybody.
Yeah. I mean, I understand he's trying to, you know, kind of have like this sloth kind of character to him. You know, he comes in very slow paced, then he hypes things up. You know, I would hate to touch his sunglasses. You know, it's like, hey, that's personal. You know, you're touching a man's glasses.
The day that he was standing on the stage and the Lucha Brothers came out of nowhere, and I think it was Pentagon came out and kicked him square in the fucking head. Where he looked like he wasn't even paying attention. I loved it. I'm not gonna lie, I thought it was the greatest thing ever. But like I said, I think the guy's more than capable in ring. He has definitely, yeah, I've come around a little bit as far as like his skill goes. It's just the gimmick that I necessarily can't even tolerate, because, you know, when I think of professional wrestlers, the first wrestlers I think of are guys like, and you know, Bret Hart, Arn Anderson, the other guy, Chris Benoit. Like, those are my favorites, some of my favorites. Owen Hart, obviously, I know he's a favorite of yours, too. It's like, I like guys that take the business seriously and will go out there and treat the business with respect and wrestle. Not some guy that just dressed like he came out of some fucking hipster bar, fucking, you know, listening to some, like, shitty-ass indie rock band or some bullshit. You know?
Speaking of bars, there is a match I am going to send you just for shits and giggles.
Go for it, brother. I'm always open.
I'm not sure where the setting was, but it had to have been like one of those like outdoor bars, and it was a match between him and another one of your favorites and one of your child's favorites, Cole Cabana. And during the whole duration of the match, they went through like all these holds while still holding a beer without spilling it.
Get the fuck out! You're gonna have to show that to me. You're going to have to send that to me. So I'm going to have to, I've never heard of this before.
It's hilarious. And like, even a referee gets involved too, and they're doing like all these like arm locks, and they're just like, oh, don't spill the beer, you know?
One of the things about like Cole Cabana is he's known as like a comedy wrestler, but he's one hell of a technical wrestler. You know, he gets viewed as like in the comedy thing, and some people were like, oh, you don't like comedy wrestlers, but you love Cole Cabana. It's because when he wrestles, it reminds me of like Steven Regal in a way, because he could really wrestle like a Steven Regal or William Regal, whatever the fuck you want to call him. But he can actually go out there and put on one of the greatest technical matches you want to see. I mean, he might throw comedy in there here and there, but he is a very good technical wrestler. And he's a former NWA World Champion, two-time NWA World Champion, and that is the greatest belt.
And I mean, yeah, like, back at it too, I mean, the guy does have like a collegiate background. I believe he did play
football. Yes.
He trained with possibly one of the best wrestlers of the 2000s with CM Punk.
They were best friends at one point as well, but no longer from, but that's right. You know, that's not, they're not my
Sick and City Sins or something like that.
Second City Sins, I believe. Yep. And of course, I got a great gift from my buddy Dan the Beast right here with me, the Best of Cole Cabana in Ring of Honor DVD. And I just watched that actually the other day. It's funny because I watched it, and it's funny to watch the early Ring of Honor compared to today's Ring of Honor. It's basically like all the indie shows I go to, it's just like watching that kind of a thing. It's like, you know, it's in the gym, which is, you know.
But the way you really got to look at it, it doesn't really have that independent vibe as it used to. You know, you watch Ring of Honor nowadays, it kind of has that NXT setup.
Right, they've grown into a professional wrestling organization as opposed to an NWA, or excuse me, as an independent wrestling organization that they once were. Those early events, I really enjoyed a lot of the early events. I think I attended a few in Jesus Christ, Fairfield and Woodbridge. They were in Woodbridge. They ran three shows, and I'm trying to think, like 2005, 2006.
I did see one event. It had to have been like 2005. There was one ROH event. It had like Samoa Joe. Like, I think he was like main eventing or something. It had to have been like a 2000.
Where was it?
Big Dampier.
Let's see. I don't. Either I remember Dan I attended. Or Fair.
It was either Danbury or Fair.
Okay, I remember I attended two shows in Fairfield. One of them, the main event was Low-Key and Dan Moff, and I remember Low-Key was working real stiff with Dan Moff and ended up giving him a concussion. I remember seeing him in Hartford at the convention center. Rascal Flatts were playing at the Meadows the same night, which it was directly behind the arena. So I remember seeing them run two shows there. It was very difficult to get to the venue because of the fucking traffic for a fucking Rascal Flatts concert. And I remember they ran three shows in Woodbridge. When I lived in Woodbridge, I grew up in Woodbridge. It was there's a building called a sports center or something like that. It's behind. It was literally on the same road that I lived on. I just had to cross the street and go behind the baseball park. And basically, it was one of CM Punk's last events that he ever worked for Ring of Honor. And someone threw a Pepsi bottle at him, and he chased him through the baseball field that same fucking night. And I remember it was fucking. We were all expecting lots of craziness that evening because everybody knew. I think it had already been announced that he had signed to WWE.
Right.
So I'm waiting.
Well, didn't he sign one of his? I don't know if it was storyline or kayfabe or whatever, but didn't he actually sign his contract at a Ring of Honor show?
That's a good question. That I don't recall. So, I
remember seeing something on his documentary on the WWE Network. Like, he literally, pulled out his contract and he, signed it right then and there. But I'm not sure if that was, actually, kayfabe or, maybe he took a copy of it and just said, hey, I'll do it again. Just for...
I'm going to have to check that. I'm going to have to check into that because that's very interesting to think about. So, anyways, there was something else I wanted to mention, but I don't remember. I don't know. What else you got, Dan, tonight before we wrap it up? We got a few more minutes we can go.
Oh, man. Well, I know I got a lot of these shoot interviews to watch and cover. As I've been telling you, probably the past night or two, I've been watching NWA Power.
What do you think of that?
It's interesting. I mean, I've learned that Tim Storm is a mama's boy.
He's possibly the greatest babyface since Ricky Steamboat, as far as his character goes.
He's interesting. He's definitely interesting. I'm really starting to like Eli Drake just a little bit more.
I'm going to tell you, since he came into the NWA, I wasn't sold on him in Impact completely until he left. I was there for his last match in Impact in New York, Bound for Glory. This event seems to keep coming up for some reason at Bound for Glory 2018. For some reason, I wasn't completely sold on him. But then watching him for a little while after that, I got into him. And then he came into the NWA, and the NWA, I'm sold on any NWA, no matter what. Those three initials, those three letters, they come up, I'm completely sold. So,
I've been completely drawn in just because of the fact that, it really brings old school, studio shows with Jim Crockett. Yeah. And, it's different, obviously, because it's modern day wrestling and all, but, right. You're seeing guys,
when you got guys like Edge and The Rock and big names like that, not only them, but saying, oh my God, this is some great shit online, basically on Twitter. Not that they said those exact words, but you know what I mean? You're getting the gist of it. You got a good fucking product,
I'm probably on the third or fourth episode at the moment, but I'm still waiting for Nick Aldis. What the hell's her name? Camille or something like that. Yep. I'm still waiting for her to talk. She pisses me off. I don't know shit about her. But it's
you're gonna be there for a while, basically. So that's all I gotta say. So. That's actually my favorite TV show, and now obviously part of that whole speaking out movement, the VP David Lagana is no longer with the NWA, so he was basically resigned, so they've halted all production, so they're not going to be producing anything. I have not seen anything as of yet. If I missed it, I don't think so, but they they're not going to be doing anything anytime soon.
I hope they keep going. I hope they come out with season 2 on DVD, because season 1 packing.
It'll come out because they've done, I believe, 3 seasons, I think. So I think that they're going to it's a matter of time when the pandemic is over, all that bullshit, that they're going to be doing another whenever they decide to get up and running again.
Right. Just like the fact that they're keeping it like old school too, you know, just with like television title tournament that they had a couple months back.
One of the things I'm going to be honest with you about the television title tournament that irritates me the most, or the not necessarily the tournament, but the whole situation with it, is that they run the title matches are 6 minutes and 5 seconds, which is some bullshit. Because every TV title match when I was growing up had a 10-minute time limit. So, right. So, I mean, they're just doing that, the 6:05, and I was just like, well, it's just odd to me, in a way, that they would do that. So, I don't know, but Zicky Dice apparently has been granted his release from the NWA. Maybe you haven't seen him. I don't know, because I don't think he pops up until season 2-ish. He eventually becomes the NWA TV champion, and from what I understand, I've read something that said he wasn't necessarily a team player. So, you know, where everybody in the back was always, you know, they're all buddy-buddy and stuff. So, who really knows, though? I'm not sitting back there. I'm not one of those guys that's sitting back there. So, I don't know. So, what else we got, Dan? Is that all for this week?
Yeah, I'm probably going to have to wrap it up.
Why don't you, Dan, the Beast, tell everybody how to find you on the social medias?
All right. If you guys want to find me on Facebook, named Danny Bryant. If you guys want to find me on Instagram, it is D_Banshee187. And, of course, you guys can find me on YouTube as DannyTheBeast94. And make sure you subscribe, especially if you're watching my channel and you're not subscribed. What are you doing? Hit that button and stay tuned for very much more content from me and the gentleman, the professor, I should say, Rick Del Santo, because this is something that we're just going to keep doing. You know, we're pushing this forward. I'm extremely humble, very honored to be a part of this, you know, and it's kind of like this was meant to be, because it was like I came across one of his videos one day and I was just like, huh. And I seen the location of where he was, and I'm like,
I was completely surprised.
And then when I found out, we just started communicating more, and then all of a sudden it was like, hey, want to be on the podcast? It's like, me? Like, yeah.
I was completely surprised that you were literally about 20 minutes from me, probably if that at the most 20 minutes from me. So, you know, we're going back and forth in the beginning, liking each other's videos, commenting on each other's videos, found each other on social media, said, hey, let's collaborate, do this podcast thing, you know? So, that part I really liked a lot, and I'm glad that, we've become pretty good friends over that time period, and I really enjoy just sitting, shooting the shit, talking professional wrestling, basically two nights out of the week. Well, I mean, we literally go basically 7 days out of the week, but we record maybe two, maybe three nights out of the week. So,
right.
However, we're definitely working towards more content. And we've got a lot of things in the works for people. And by the way, I want to mention this. There's only 2 days left. Up for grabs is a Best of Marco Stunt Blu-ray and a Marco Stunt pin. So if you hop over to my Instagram and find that post, it's actually the first post, or just click and it says to enter the contest, all you have to do is comment the word enter and you are entered in the contest. We got a lot of people entered into this contest, so I'm really excited. Tuesday night, Dan and I are gonna fucking draw the name. Tuesday night, whether it's going to be posted on YouTube and Instagram. We're going to do an Instagram live. I don't know. I didn't tell you that, actually. So guess what, Dan? We're doing it live. So now that you know.
All right. Okay.
So we're looking to do that. And we've got so much content coming up. We've got all sorts of talent from the world of independent wrestling that are looking to come on the show. I've been contacted by a bunch of people. Not to mention our two nights a week that we are doing regularly, Dan and I, between Sunday and Tuesday, and like I said, any random fucking night that we decide to record during our bonus episodes, we've got a lot of talent that are interested in coming in, coming on, and so you're going to be seeing a shit ton of content for me. We might even get to seven fucking nights a week. I don't know. It's very possible with all the people that are in contact with me and talking to me. So, and we've been just, I'm just excited we're doing this podcast. I got a great fucking crew here between Dan and JJ, and we just shoot the shit every day, basically talking professional wrestling. I know I'm fucking rambling here, but if you want to find me on social media, find me on Twitter, The Rick Del Santo. Find me on Instagram, The Rick Del Santo. You can like my, my YouTube page, The Professor Rick Del Santo. That is the show's page where all sorts of bullshit is posted there. And you can find me on Facebook. I don't normally. We're in the works of getting a page of set up for the actual show.
Yes.
We're in the works of that. And if anybody is listening, is a logo creator, we're looking to get some new artwork done. Hit us up, prowrestlezone@gmail.com. So, anybody that's listened tonight, I appreciate you. This is the first episode that we've gone for fucking this long, and I'm very happy about it. So, everybody, have a great evening.
Take care, guys.